good too.
It's a little messy.
I like that, the cherries a little more shavy.
Ooh, oh, you don't like cherries?
The only good thing I've ever gotten from chili.
Thank you.
Good morning, my name is Joel, Joel Chenet, and I'm from Kodiak in Alaska. And what we're going to do, we're going to do an halibut dish and a salmon dish. And I did a presentation because I'm on my way to Monterey Aquarium to do some cooking demonstration over there. And it's a celebration of the Aleutic people on Kodiak. That's the 100th anniversary of the discovery of some masks. And I've been doing some presentation for the museum. And at the same time in Monterey, I'm going to use this. And I'm going to put some king crab claws all around. Like if the mask is feathers. And that's going to be king crab all around. And this work, when it's done, will look like all wood. This is not done yet, but I did that to give you an idea of what we can do. So I'm going to take this out right now because it's not dry yet. Cold smoked salmon. Over here we have Alaskan salmon, which is smoked with hardwood, 140 degrees for about 6 or 7 hours. So you get very hard. Then if you keep it for about 20 hours, you have jerky, skull candies. And this is really nice. Then you have sockeye fillets, boneless. Then you have the same fish over here, all, which if you go on the market and you ask for HNG, which is headed and gutted, that's what it is, it's ready to go. Just have to fillet it. And we are going to do that with smoked paprika, beer, shallots, tomatoes, clam juice. And it's going to be served in a phyllo cup. And in between the layers, I put some nori sheets. So you get a sea flavor with it. Or you can put seaweed powder between your layers also. Salt and pepper. Not too much paprika because you don't want to lose the flavor of your fish, but you want that smoky flavor. Well, be sure your pan is nice and hot. That's right, don't do that at all. Tomatoes, juice.
By the way, did everybody receive a recipe?
Yes.
No. We have more recipes yet?
Salmon cook very, very fast. Piece like that is going to take about 3 to 5 minutes. Maybe put your tomatoes and your shallots and your beer. Clam juice. Cream.
Je vais parler un peu plus fort, je vais être. Parce que j'ai mis l'air conditionnel.
Ok. Okay, then you tell me.
Yeah, why? I need to go.
Then you make some nice light mashed potatoes.
By the way, Joel is competing on Friday night.
Saturday night.
No, Saturday night with the Iron Chefs. And
where
is
you?
It?
Yes, I am.
Saturday.
We don't know, it's four chefs involved in it. I don't know all the details. It's kind of a surprise. When we're there, we're going to know what's going to happen. And on Friday, I'm going to do some cooking demonstration with Alton Brown.
Alton Brown?
Mm-hmm. And when your sauce is getting thicker, you add a little bit of raw butter in it. Salmon.
Also, by the way, you remember the gentleman who was really mauled by a bear?
Yeah.
Huh? Well, knows him personally very well.
I used to know him.
Yeah.
Okay, now we're going to do. We are going to do the halibut. Something you want your pan very, very hot.
What is the biggest size you ever got the halibut, Chef Joel?
200 pounds.
200 pounds?
Yep.
Wow.
70 pound linker. This bigger one waiting for me over there.
Wow.
So what you do, you take your halibut, salt and pepper. Yeah. Mm-hmm. Then you season it. Tamar guys, please. And season it with flour very, very lightly. Just to get the color. Then you put a little bit Italian seasoning. Be sure your pan is very, very hot. Sauté vegetable, and you can use any kind of vegetables. We have plenty in California, so don't be shy about experimenting with artichoke bottom, fresh fennel, everything you can think of. Halibut. Pieces like this are cooked about a minute and a half. Always, you know, the fish, always be sure it doesn't go over about 120 degrees. If not, it's getting harder and harder. Don't put it in the oven at 350 degrees for 20 minutes, you know, that's not good. And your vegetable green ones, the mushrooms. You can use fish stock if you have some, if not clam juice will do. That's almost done. White wine. Clam juice. You reduce it almost to high. Yes. Mm-hmm. Or fish stock, you know. And what we're making is in France, it's called a blanket, which usually is done with veal, but we do it with halibut today. And you see, it's almost dry. Now we have the cream. And if you do this for a banquet, what you can do is make a cream sauce so that you don't have to wait 2 hours to reduce it. Just get your sauce ready in advance, just do your fish. Yes. Mm-hmm. Then what you want to do is a pinch of nutmeg, very, very little, but to get that nutty flavor. And you finish it with egg yolk. And that's going to give you the richness of the sauce. Okay, we are ready to play. So you take your phyllo cup, put it sideways like this. And try not to squeeze your fish, like keep those nice cubes. And you put your vegetable in the back over here. Six.
It wasn't meant to be.
No, it's the tip of the tongs are bending on the outside. Deal. And before you eat it, you squeeze a piece of lemon on it. There you go. You have your halibut. Any questions?
Great job.
You're welcome.
How many years have you been cooking?
I don't know, about 40 something.
What's your specialty? What is it like
about? I don't know, I like about everything. You know, from cooking, meat, fish. I've been doing more and more fish, and I've been involved with the fishery in Alaska now for the last 3 years. I've been working with the University of Alaska, developing recipes. And if not, meat is fine. butchering, then baking, bread baking, doesn't matter. That's one thing in Europe, when you do your training, you have to be around chef. You have to learn everything. Making ice cream, you name it.
Well, what is what's the deal? If you can make something all the time, what's the one thing that you would make?
Sculpture.
That's what I want to learn in my life. When I was a kid, I wanted to be a sculptor. I wanted to learn to make bronzes. And my father said, no way. You get a job, and after that, you do whatever you want. And hopefully one day I will have the chance to go to school and learn to do it. Because I can do that with sugar, I can do it with chocolate, I can do it with ice, I can do ice carving. But I want to learn bronzes.
Your nationality?
I'm French.
French?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Hi, Jeff.
Hi. There you go.
Can we have the scallop recipe?
Sorry?
Can we have
Thank
the scallop recipe?
And guess if you know I bought recipe,
yeah.
Let me know because I gave it to Patty. Unless you know somebody took some already. Give me the original and I make the copies. Of our student to a friend of Joel's and a lodge. She really enjoyed very much. Joel forgot to tell you he has also a restaurant, coffee shop, bakery. And Kodiak, okay? And he's hiring quite a bit of people for the summertime,
yes.
Too.
Yeah.
Now, it's an excellent contact, especially there, you know, you have, you know, free living when you go there. Lodging, fabulous. People pay between $5,000 and $8,000 a week. I hope so, going with my son-in-law and Joel again, you know, on the month of July,
yes.
And possibly fly from here to Anchorage to Kodiak if the weather.
Yep.
And from Kodiak, we're mostly taking a bush plan and going fishing.
Going to a lodge, yeah. Spend the night
lodge.
In a lodge and do some fishing,
yeah.
Salmon fishing. And
sure.
Who gets picked or how do you.
Yeah.
Who gets picked or how do you. Is there a pool or something?
Find me.
The strongest person, somebody who's not mine.
And one of them. It's illegal, he cannot do it, but he did it anyway. He was rolling it. Then Joanne went to see, said, by the way, that Salman didn't catch it legally, so would you mind you to release it? Okay. And that's what happened. When you go there, literally, you can walk. When they run, as well,
yeah.
You can walk on the Salmans there.
Yeah,
so many
well, you have seen pictures, you know, the Salman side by side. That's what it is. You can walk on fish. That's
yeah.
Amazing.
Sure.
Yes.
How old were you when you first decided you want to start, you know, this profession? And, like, did you start out, like, at a restaurant on the line, or did you go to school first, or how much did you know, like,
well,
something when you first started?
It's two parts there. One, I was born in a restaurant. My parents had a restaurant, so I was born in it. And that's why the reason I don't wanted to be in the business, because I knew what it was. And that's why my father, I was doing a lot of horseback riding and car racing. And my dad said, you know, you have to get a job. And I never looked for a job, and finally signed a three-year contract for me in 1963, and, no, 64, sorry. And in 67, I graduated as the best, after all competition, five competition, I became the best young chef in France, and opened a lot of doors for me. One thing in France, where you have to do your duties, you have to go to the army for, you know, 6 months a year. Now it's over, but that was 16 months for me, and I wanted, so I'm great, I'm going to the Navy, so I'm going to travel. Well, I ended up being the chef for the admiral for 16 months, and I stayed in her house. But it was nice, you know, I feed the admiral, his wife, his kids. It was fun. Then from there, I went back to work with my former chef in a castle, and I wanted to go out of the country, and I work in England, I work in Switzerland, Germany, South Africa, Madagascar. Then I came to the state in 75 for 4 weeks to set up all the parties for the bicentennial for the French president, for do that in 76. And they asked me to stay, and well, I'm still here. And in the state, I work in New York City for 7 years at the Pierre Hotel and Citibank, that's Embassy and Consulate, then the Pierre, then Citibank, then moved to Vermont to the first Relais Chateau Hotel, which was a three-star hotel, and worked very, very hard, and we got a four-star. And from there, I moved to Boston, to Parker House, which is the oldest hotel in this country, and went to Cape Cod for the same company. I took the job from Emir Lagasse when he left. And from there, moved to Syracuse, New York, took care of 5 restaurants, old gentleman. And from there, went to the Buffalo Club in Buffalo, New York, which is the oldest private club. And I stayed there for 9 years as the chef, executive chef. And problem with the manager, moved to retail, to a gourmet shop, like, you know, if you have seen Balducci in New York City, very high-end prepared food, like 30 different salads and entrees, and, you know, very interesting. And over the years, I had this young man that I met in Vermont, works for me in a bakery. He graduated from Johnson Well University as a baker. His dream was to go to Alaska, then he moved, and he's a state trooper over there, and game biologist also. And he kept telling me, come to Alaska. And when he get married, I did come to Alaska, spent a month over here, which was absolutely fantastic, on Kodiak and Delta Junction, and with a lot of hunting and fishing. And he opened a coffee shop on top of his job, and he did it up. And I, at that time at the club, I had 3 weeks vacation. So for 3 years in a row, I spent 3 weeks in Alaska. And finally, I said, what? I'm moving. So I sent my wife. She spent about a month over here, loved it. We moved to Kodiak. It has been 10 years now.
Also, Joel, would you mind to explain to students, do special parties on the yacht? He is a personal friend from, what is it, the Harbor Commission? What is it?
Harbor Master.
Harbor Master from Kodiak.
Yeah, he has a beautiful yacht, and we do dinner cruise. And if he has, you know, regular customers and things like that, the wife does the job. But if we have VIP, we had a king from Sweden coming in, some ministers, and I go on board and do the cooking on the boat. It's a lot of fun. And I also fly to some lodges when they have VIP people. They pick me up with a plane, and I go spend the day cooking, do the breakfast, lunch, and sometimes go fishing with them, which is a lot of fun, and come back and do the dinners and fly back the same night or early in the morning the next day. So it's a lot of opportunities over there to do things. The only thing is remote, though, you know, we have only one theater. TV works sometimes doesn't, but we have one supermarket and Walmart for shopping, and that's about it.
And it's dark. Walmart. How many months a year is it dark?
On Kodiak, about 3 months, and it's not completely dark, you know. It gets dark by 6 o'clock at night and light by 10, but right now, about 4:45, we have light until about 11:30. By June, we have about 23 hours of daylight.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah. I couldn't live
with
that.
Yeah.
So when, obviously, for doing all of this stuff, for specialty food, for all that stuff, like, where do you get your supplies? I mean, your grocery store can't be that great.
No, that's one of the things. You know, that's what I was telling you earlier this morning. You know, when I see an avocado, a case of avocado for $8 or whatever, I'm paying $4 for an avocado.
For each one?
Yeah, each one.
Oh, wow.
$3 for a lemon. $2 for a tomato.
Oh my God.
Yeah. But on the other hand, I can go and fish 70 salmon for free and go fishing every day and catch 7 fish.
Where's,
you know,
the best fishing spot?
Well, they are all over. You know, with the tide is the oceans, you know, so, and same with the river. According to the tide, the fish go up. So sometimes they go in one river, sometimes they go to the other. So you have to keep in touch with the customers, with the fish and game. So that's touch and go, you know, same with hunting. Yeah, that's why it's so expensive. You know, everything comes either by plane or by barge out of Seattle. So something takes 1 week, something takes 3 weeks. So it's a lot of planning, and I'm glad I work in Madagascar, because it was the same kind in the island, that sometimes it was 2 months to get things. So it's same with the lodge, you know, because everything with a plane, and now the gas is $4.19 over there. The airplane gas is almost $5. So if you are a chef in a lodge and it's 2 hours of flying, you're talking about $600 or $700 of airplane. Wow. To bring you the butter. So you be sure that plane is not only the butter on board, that's everything you need.
Do you fly?
Oh yeah.
Fly a lot.
I mean, you're the pilot.
I
no.
I wish.
What is your favorite fish to eat?
Rock bass. I love rock bass. But yeah, rock black bass.
Rock,
yeah. Rock. And also cod, fresh cod. You cannot beat that. But everything, you know, you have sea urchins, you have scallops, yeah, king crab, yeah. No.
Question that one.
Yeah.
So your produce is more expensive, but is your crab legs and your salmon?
That's very expensive.
That's more expensive too?
Yeah.
It seems like it would be cheaper.
Well, we can go fishing for our own carp.
You get
yeah,
your
we put the pots in the water and, you know, get
but
our
to
own.
Buy it in the store, it's going to
yeah,
be
yeah, it's about $20 a pound for a king crab.
Wow.
Yeah.
You're getting ripped off.
But I don't know if you have seen the movie The Deadliest Catch.
Oh, I'm obsessed.
Okay. When you see people by 0 degree, minus 20, on the ice catching the crab, let me tell you,
we
they deserve every penny
it.
Of it. No. You know, that's why it's so expensive. And now, you know, the problem with the boat, the fuel, actually is right now, some halibut boats are not going out and some cod boats are not going because the fish are not around and it costs so much money to look for the fish. By the time they come back, they spend more money on gas. So they are waiting for, it's going to be the challenge for the salmon season. You see the way the boats are going. They're not going to be able to be cruising all around for days and days to find the fish. So we don't know what's going to happen. And one thing I did, you know, for the last 6 years now, is the first salmon of the year. What I do, we take one location to do a dinner. Opening day at noon, so I fly around 5-6 o'clock in the morning to either on a beach or the set net like you saw, or on a boat. And we catch the first fish and I get, you know, 5, 10, 20, 30 fish, whatever I need, fly back to town, clean the fish, and do a 6-course meal, all of us, all salmon. And with some people who helped me out, some volunteers, and all the money goes to charities. Wow. And the last 2 years I've been giving, you know, most of the money to the Wanted Warriors project. We have, last year we had 15 Wanted Warriors coming in. This year we have 30. And it's amazing when you see those people, you know. It was a gentleman from San Diego, from the Philippines. He was missing his right hand, his left leg. He had a prosthesis, and he was running, he was catching, and unfortunately, I forgot the video from them. You see him with his left hand and that leg, and he's fighting about 150 pound halibut, and he has so much fun. He's laughing, it's just amazing. And he gets so tired with one hand that he gets this hand, and he don't want to get that hand out because he can pop out and go in the ocean. So he's using his arm like this and struggling this fish, you know, and he's just, yeah, I'm the man, you know. It was awesome, you know.
Good.
He was a blind gentleman, which was amazing. After 2 days being on the boat, he bring the fish on board and he touch it. Oh, that's a cod. That's a flounder. It was amazing, you know, just by touch. Yeah, but we never fishing. He was from Pennsylvania, never been in the ocean before, you know, but just in 2 days. Yeah. Yeah, but I put you a flounder and halibut side by side, you tell me, or a sole, and if you don't see, yeah, you can figure it out if you know what you're looking for. Any other questions?
I have a question.
Yeah.
Putting the beer, when you put the beer in, is there going to be a slight flavor of beer?
Yes. Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's going to be a bitterness, and that's what you want. Yeah. Mm-hmm. With the smoke of the paprika, it just gives you a right balance of flavor. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Nice.
Is that beer from Alaska? To be quite honest, I've never seen
Spain.
From Spain.
Huh? Alpine
beer.
Village.
Yeah, we have some good beer. We have microbreweries in Alaska. Actually, we have one on Kodiak, which is another thing now with the thing of the ethanol. All the farmers are doing corn to make ethanols, but all the hops and all the ingredients for beer are getting sky highs. So the price of beer this summer is going to be, who knows?
Because of the yeast.
That's good for people
that
don't drink.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, do you have any more questions to Chef Joel?
Do you have cards to pass out?
Yes. Mm-hmm. And I wish you good luck, and you know, this is a good trade. Like I told you, I went all over the world, and I wish I had done more, but it's a good thing that you, most of the, if you are, you know, in somewhere else, you get room and board, and you're always going to have food.
Right.
And one thing I did all over the world is I always worked 2 jobs. One job I was paid, and the other one I was volunteering. In a bakery, in a butcher shop, in another kitchen, wherever I can learn, I went. When I work at Sprigli in Zurich, it's one of the best well-known bakeries in Switzerland. And they have a program where a student, at that time, that was 1971, it cost you $200 a day to be learning from the chefs. Well, by going and working for free, every afternoon for 4 hours between my breaks, because we used to do work morning and night, I was getting all those classes for free. And I learned a lot. When I started at the Borolac, I was coming from England, I worked at the garde-manger, And it's not actually, I was there just before Christmas. I did about, I don't know, 30 pieces for the buffets. And chef called me, and that's the old fashioned, when you were called in a chef's office, you're turning white because you don't go often in a chef's office. And so, well, what's happening? He said, well, we're so happy with you, we're going to put you as the chef of the grill room. And the grill room at the Borlac was the place, if you had money to be. And all the chef de parties and sous chef de parties were between 25 and 50 years old. Guys been doing fish for 30 years. And you are there, you are 22 years old, and you are going to walk next to him, and then all of a sudden you're going to take his job. You better prove yourself. And let me tell you, that was hard. But I did it, and you know, worked out good for me. But just keep going, you know, and read books, practice. You know, when you do at home, you can see you can cook in 5 minutes. You know, you don't need a, so your friends come over, you know, do this, do that, and just keep. And in the kitchen, you know, it's speed, speed, speed. Because it's nice, you're at a school, you know, you're just having a good time, but in real life, you don't. You know. Like at my shop, I have a housewife burner, 4 burners, and I do dinners for 200. So it takes a lot of thinking how you're going to do it, and but you can do it. And we go in the bush. I've cooked meals for, you know, 25, 30 people on the beach with an open fire and do some nice dishes with fish. You know, I have a big cast iron pan and I do dishes like that on the beach where the fish has been caught by you. And you say, hey, look at my fish. Okay, that's going to be our lunch. Yeah. Okay. And it's a lot of fun.
Okay, excuse me, Sean.
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Okay, young lady, mm-hmm. and I like, if possible, mm-hmm. massage Joel when I went fishing. Joel worked also in a cannery.
Yes, that's another experience. When I started working over here at the bakery, we were doing only breakfast pastries. So I got there by 4 in the morning, by 7 I was done. And my wife was still in Buffalo, in New York, so I was bored. And I said, well, I'm going to go to work in a cannery. So I asked one of the directors, can I work in the cannery? He said, what do you want to do? I said, A to Z. And went from taking the fish out of the boat and walk the line. And the line, you have the fish coming in, and he's coming in front of you, and you take the cod. The first line I did is cod. And those fish are passing by, you get the fish, fillet it, pull it behind you, and it goes on another place. I did halibut, and you don't know what's coming in. You have halibut, it's 10 pounds, the other one is 20 pounds, one is 250 pounds, one is 400 pounds. So now that's a challenge to move a 400 pound fish on the table and cut it in pieces, and then it goes. It's dirty, because you have fish guts everywhere.
Smelly.
It smells fish, you know, that's, I don't know, doesn't bother me. You have water running, so you have full gear. And you have Filipino people or Spanish people all speaking their own language. Very loud because of the noise. You have the radio blasting. And let me tell you, after 8 hours of that, whew, it's hard. It's hard. And that's what, you know, something we say, the fish is expensive, but it's a lot of steps. Then after that, you figure a freezer like this, you know, a big freezer like this, which is a very, very small, you know, their freezer as big as this school over here. It costs you about $5,000 a day to run, to keep those fish. So if you put this by 365 days to keep the fish in there, then it goes to Seattle on the barge, who is also refrigerated. So that's why it's very expensive.
Okay. Joel, one is to ask if you can filleting a salmon.
Sure, yeah.
Okay. Have a good look how fast it goes at that one, okay? By the time you see it, it's over.
I'm sorry. Mm-hmm.
Can we do it here? So
yeah. Somebody has a shot. Give me that. Yeah. Yeah. So the first thing you do is to remove the color over here. And this, what we do, we brine this and we smoke it. This is really, really good. And one thing I do also, I cut them like this, remove all this meat over here, and make salmon wings, and deep fry them. So nothing's wasted.
What advice do you have for people starting their first job on this program.
Be very modest. Find a job that you like and work as hard as you can and keep, you know, if you have the chef tell you, say, okay, fillet five fish, you're done. Don't wait. What am I going to do now? Go to the chef or your sous chef. What can I do? Just keep going. And on the long run, it'll pay off. What I do with all my trimmings from the fish, I make dog and cat cookies.
Make what?
Dogs and cat cookies.
It spends the time you are in the process of producing cookies for
There you go.
Do that when I do it.
That's great.
Do that.
Excellent job.
Wow.
You're welcome. And also what they do on Kodiak is a gentleman who make wallets. Out of the skins.
Really?
Yeah,
really?
And that's beautiful. Actually, I wanted to get one and I just so many things to do, I did not.
You don't have to go buy a wallet.
Yeah.
You don't need a wallet in the kitchen.
Yeah,
okay, so. If you don't have any more questions, have a good day. First semester is due tomorrow, 8 o'clock. Working on the test tomorrow, okay? 8 o'clock tomorrow.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.